say three times Mrityunjay mantra. Our Jnaniyamma is very ill and she's in ICU or something. Yesterday she came to the class and today suddenly she's not very well. Her son rang, it seems. Just to say three times. And she's one of her very, very, very serious students. Om Harihi Om Tatsat Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om Om Shri Mahaganapataye Namaha Om Ganana Aam Tva Ganapatikam Havamahe Kavim Kave Namupamashravastamam Jeshtarajam Brahmanam Brahmanaspata Anashranvannoti Bisseda Sadhanam Om Shri Mahaganapataye Namaha Om Shuklam Baradaram Vishnum Shashivarnam Chaturbhujam Prasannavadanam Dhyayet Sarva Vignopashantaye Gajananam bhuta ganadi sevitam kapitta jambu phalasara bhakshitam umasutam shoka vinashakaranam namami vigneshwara pada pankajam om shri mahaganapataye namaha om hrim namah shivaya om trambakaya jamahe sugandhim pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva bandhanan vrityor mukshiyamamrutat Om Hrim Namah Shivaya Om Trambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva bandhanan vrityor mukshiyamamrutat Om Hrim Namah Shivaya Om Trambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrutat Om Hrim Namah Shivaya Om Trambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrutat Om Hrim Namah Shivaya Om Trambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrutat Om Hrim Namah Shivaya Om Trambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva bandhanan mrityor mukshiyamamrutat Om Hrim Namah Shivaya Om Trambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva bandhanan mrityor mukshiyamamrutat Om Hrim Namah Shivaya Om Trambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrutat Om Hrim Namah Shivaya Om Trambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrutat Om Hrim Namah Shivaya Om Trambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva Bandhanan Mrityor Mukshiyamamrutat Om Hrim Namah Shivaya Om Trambakaya Jamahe Sugandhim Pushtivardhanam Urvarukamiva bandhanan mrityor mukshiyamamrutat Om Shanti. this is the temple. When I came to London first, I never hadn't known many people that time. I used to come on my own and sit and do my Chandi Parayanam, just sit in front of Devi on my own and walk back from here to Mommy's house. I hadn't even known Yashoda, and she recognized me doing Chandi. My Chandi part brought Yashoda to my class. That day onward, she's been with me. It's another Maharaj, Sheelama, next to Sheelama.
My sister's
young. Vasudeva sutam devam kamsa chanuramardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langhayate Girim Yat Krupa Tamaham Vande Paramananda Madhavam Yam Brahma Varunendra Rudra Marutaha Stunvanti divyai stavaihi vedai sangapadakramopanishadaihi gayantiyam samaga dhyanavasthita tadgatena manasa pashyantiyam yogino yasyantam navidusura suragana Devaya tasmai namaha Om Shri Paramatmane namaha. We are supposed to start today the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Entitled as Jnana Karma Sanyasa Yoga. We all know very well the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita presents the context of the teaching. Wherein we understand the cause of samsara being ragaha, shokaha, mohaha. Ragaha implies, ragaha means attachment, passion, but implies emotional dependence. Somebody's looking for the place. Then Dveshaha literally means hatred or aversion. Implying grief. Shokaha No, Shokaha, Ragaha, then Ragaha also, aversion is Desha, then Shokaha imply, means grief. Then when you become emotionally dependent, you can't help being subject to grief. And when you are in grief, you will be naturally confused. You can't be very clear. So Mohaha. This Raga, Shoka, Mohaha. Ragaha, Shokaha, Mohaha. This is mainly because of Ajnanam, ignorance of the self, or you can say ignorance of the truth. Samsarasya moola karanam ajnanam. Ignorance means the root cause of the samsara bondage. We understand from the first chapter wherein the context of teaching is presented. And only when Arjuna asked for knowledge, Krishna taught him. Because many times the question comes, why Krishna chose to teach Arjuna, not anybody else? Nobody else asked for jnana. If Duryodhana or anybody else, even among the Pancha Pandavas, Yudhishthira or Bhima, or somebody else asked for jnanam, Krishna would have given the knowledge. The only Arjuna asked for knowledge desperately, especially when he became the victim of the sorrow caused by confusion when he was, because of his attachment. And when he asked, Karpanya dosha upahata swabhavaha Prichamitvam dharma sammudha chetaha yachreyasyat nischitam bruhitanme sishyasteham aham te sishyaha shadhimam, please protect me. When he sought protection, yachreyasyat nischitam bruhi, please tell me definitely only that which will free me from sorrow. That is when Krishna taught. So why Arjuna was chosen? Arjuna asked for jnanam, he got it. And the whole second chapter, you know very well, presents the entire teaching of Bhagavad Gita in a nutshell. This also I told you in my previous classes, but because we're all together here, I just thought, let me do it properly here. Always in the tradition, in any Vedantic text you see, take, generally, the entire teaching is presented in a nutshell, and the brief presentation of the entire teaching is called Upakramaha. Then again, the entire teaching is presented elaborately. The elaborate presentation of the entire teaching is called Vistaraha. Again, what is elaborately discussed is presented at the end, summed up. The summary is called Upasamharaha. So always the teaching is like, you know, in the three portions, like Upakramaha, which is a brief presentation. Again, Vistaraha, elaborate teaching. Again, we have Upasamharaha, that is again brief summary. The second chapter presents the entire teaching briefly, which means what is the teaching of the Bhagavad Gita? Bhagavad Gita presents both important topics, the two important topics discussed in the Bhagavad Gita are karma yoga and jnana yoga. We don't need to break our head what else is there. Karma yoga and jnana yoga, these are the two main topics. Because the two topics are, in fact, two different means for accomplishing two ends. And these two, so we call them sadhanam. Karma yoga is a sadhanam and jnana yoga is also a sadhanam. Sadhanam means that which serves as a means for accomplishing something, an end. So what is karma yoga for? You all know very well. Karma yoga is again a sadhanam. Which is a way of life which has to be followed in order to prepare one's mind for knowledge in terms of mental purity and mental steadiness. Antahkarana shuddhyartham, antahkarana naischalyartham, naischalya praptyartham, karma yogam, no, karma yoga jivanam, Syat. May one follow a life of karma yoga. For what? What is the end that can be accomplished by living a life of karma yoga? One can become mentally prepared, ready for the knowledge. What do you need for that? What is that? So antahkarana shuddhihi, antahkarana naischalyam. That is what you can accomplish. But that is not an easy thing to accomplish. But living a life of karma yoga, accomplishing the mental purity and mental steadiness, preparation in terms of mental purity and mental steadiness itself is not an ultimate end. Not end in itself. It is only a means. Therefore, karma yoga is incomplete. Mental preparedness also will be incomplete without the jnanam. Once you're mentally prepared, then for knowledge, the jnana yoga again is a pursuit of knowledge. Jnana yoga, pursuit of knowledge. And pursuit of knowledge again is how, you know, involves three stages, three steps. In terms of shravanam, mananam and vidhyasanam. You cannot mix this. One has to go through shravanam. Shravanam later on will lead you to mananam. Once shravanam and mananam you have done, and you will have clear, doubt-free knowledge, and when you can contemplate, which is for contemplation. This contemplation will result in clear, ascertained vision, which itself is moksha. Therefore, jnana yoga, the pursuit of knowledge in terms of shravanam, mananam, nididhyasanam will result in the jnanam, and which is the sadhanam for moksha. So karma yoga is for mental preparation, jnana yoga is for jnanam, and jnanam is for moksha. Therefore, it is very important to know the value of the knowledge, which itself is moksha. After attainment of the knowledge, one need not do anything. The very knowledge itself is freedom, moksha. Knowledge is freedom. Knowledge need not be followed by any other practice. Therefore, to understand the value of knowledge, importance of knowledge, knowledge also is glorified in terms of glorification of a wise person. When a wise person is glorified, it's glorification of the wisdom, isn't it? Therefore, the wise person is glorified how? in terms of definition of a wise person. So these three topics are presented in the second chapter. But in a nutshell, very few verses are there, but very beautifully explaining Karma Yoga. And the Jnana Yoga, Krishna starts with the Jnana Yoga actually, in terms of the nature of the self, unfoldment of the nature of the self, he presents from verse number 12 to 25. In fact, you can say generally people say from 11th to 30th, all those verses come under the heading of Atma Swarupa Lakshana Pratipadaka Shlokaha. All those verses unfold the nature of the self, they say. So what is discussed briefly is elaborately discussed from the third chapter onwards till the 17th chapter. Therefore, the Vistaraha elaboration is from where the third to the 17th. But still here, the immediately after second chapter, the third chapter discusses elaborately the Karma Yoga. The Karma Yoga is subject matter of the whole of third chapter. And Jnana Yoga happens to be the pursuit of knowledge, the subject matter of the Shastram happens to be the subtlest, very subtle teaching there. The two chapters are dedicated for the elaboration of the Jnana Yoga. For the chapter 4 and chapter 5, these two chapters present the Jnana Yoga. So the second chapter is again discussed in where? In this third and the fourth and the fifth. But third chapter presents the Karma Yoga. Again, the fourth and fifth present in detail the Jnana Yoga. And here, so even though Jnana Yoga is the main topic, which means the nature of the self has to be analyzed. Because self knowledge is the knowledge of the truth, and knowledge of the truth of the whole is in fact nothing but the knowledge of one's own self. And this knowledge of the truth in terms of self-knowledge is itself is moksha. But here, for self-knowledge, we need to analyze the nature of the self. But why should we study the Shastram? Because analysis of the subject matter of the Shastram is nothing but analysis of the nature of the self. I told you already, if you have to look into your face, you have to look into the mirror. Looking into the mirror is for looking into your own face. Similarly, analyzing the subject matter of the Shastram is like looking into the mirror, and wherein your own nature is analyzed. So analysis of the nature of the self will result in self-knowledge, which implies analysis of the subject matter of the Shastram will bless you with self-knowledge. Okay? They are two different things. So the topic here is called Jnana Karma Sannyasa Yoga. And one more thing you need to know here is, we know very clearly, we have no confusions. People who are studying Vedanta Shastram, who are given the study of the Shastram, should be very clear. We have only two sadhanams, Karma Yoga and Jnana Yoga. There is no third sadhanam for moksha. Understand? And Jnana Yoga and Karma Yoga, there is no option between the two. Both the sadhanas are important. Both have to be followed, not simultaneously, no? But consequentially. Karma Yoga has to precede for preparation. Jnana Yoga has to follow after preparation and for Jnanam. Two sadhanas. There's no option. There's no choice. Should I choose to live a life of Karma Yoga or Jnana Yoga? That is what Arjuna asked in the very beginning of third chapter. And Krishna answered again, repeat. He made very clear. A sadhanam, both are important. But karma, without Karma Yoga, without mental preparation, knowledge will be impossible. And even if you live a life of Karma Yoga, you become mentally prepared also, without Jnanam, that will be incomplete. Okay? Therefore, two sadhanams, there's no third sadhanam, there's no third path. We have to understand, for a human being, whoever it is, the ultimate choiceless end is moksha. And that moksha is something to be discovered, which means discovery is the only way. We don't have many ways, not many paths. How many paths do you need? When you say discovery, you have to discover the truth, means other than discovering it, what else you have? What path is there? No other path. Discovery is the only way. It's like when you go to the temple in India, we have huge temples. And each temple from outer prakaram, we have now four ways. If you go to Madurai, Rameshwaram, all big temples, there's four entrances with Srirangam also. You can come from other side, come from this side, come from four entrances. Once you go inside, and it's a big prakaram. Again, you have to go inside. Again, you have to go inside. But to go to the Garbhagraham, Garbhagraha means the Sanctum Sanctorum, only one entrance, not many entrances. Like this, for moksha, Jnanam is the only sadhanam. Jnanam, knowledge is the way. But to prepare your mind, you have many sadhanams. Even though any sadhanam, there again Karma Yoga, you can do practice varieties of disciplines to prepare your mind. But whichever discipline you practice, there must be proper attitude, which converts the discipline into a yoga. A discipline without the Purusharta Nischaya, a discipline without the commitment to the pursuit of knowledge, a discipline practiced becomes an exercise. A discipline practiced seriously for preparing the mind for knowledge, having the knowledge as the ultimate end, having moksha as the ultimate end, and the commitment to the pursuit of knowledge, if a discipline is followed, then that discipline becomes yoga. Isn't it? So many disciplines. Therefore, to enter into the temple, you can go from any side. But when you've entered into the temple to go to the Sanctum Sanctorum, there's only one entrance, isn't it? You don't have too many entrances. Here also, it has to be very clear. So this is the word yoga should not be taken as some, there are not 18 yogas are not there. Yoga means subject matter or the topic. The topic of the fourth chapter is Jnana Karma Sanyasaha. It has to be very carefully understood. So Karma Sanyasaha literally means renunciation of actions. But here, please understand, you can underline this statement. Karma Sanyasaha does not mean giving up of physical activities. Renunciation of physical activities will be impossible. So Karma Sanyasaha does not mean giving up the physical activities, does not mean that giving up renunciation of anything. Here Karma Sanyasaha implies freeing oneself from the notions, wrong notions, that I am the doer, I am the enjoyer. Okay, so freedom from doership and enjoyership, A, alone, is implied by the term karma sannyasa. And that freeing oneself from the wrong notions that I am the doer, I am the enjoyer, is possible only if there is the knowledge, right knowledge of the self. For jnanena karma sannyasaha, jnana karma sannyasaha. Is it clear? Only in the wake of knowledge of the self, you understand self being free from doership and enjoyership. Therefore, so understanding the nature of the self, understanding the nature of reality in terms of its swarupam as one's own self, thereby freeing oneself from the wrong notions, I am the doer, I am the enjoyer, is jnana karma sannyasaha. And this is the subject matter of this chapter. So don't worry, it will become very clear. We are only in the fourth chapter. And you know very well, whatever has been discussed earlier is discussed here. Whatever is discussed here will be again discussed more elaborately. So somehow we have to become clear sometime or the other. Don't need to worry about anything. So now let us see the fourth chapter. Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha.
Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha.
Jnana Karma Sanyasa Yogo Nama. Chaturthodhyayah. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha. Imam Vivasvate Yogam. Proktavanahamauyayam. Vivasvan manave praha.
Vivasvan manave praha.
Manurikshvaka vebravit.
Manurikshvaka vebravit.
Imam vivasvate yogam.
Imam vivasvate yogam.
Proktavanahamoyayam. Vivasvan manave praha.
Vivasvan manave praha.
Manurikshvaka vebravit.
Manurikshvaka vebravit.
Even though the main topic of this chapter is Jnana Yogaha, unfoldment of the nature of the self, initially Krishna discusses some other two subtopics here. There is some diversion until the eighth verse. These eight verses, what Krishna presents is two main things. One is glorification of Bhagavad Gita itself. And the second is the concept of avataraha, incarnation. We will understand here. So first eight verses, there's a diversion. So the very first verse, Krishna starts praising Bhagavad Gita in terms of its, you know, timelessness. How to say, the Bhagavad Gita is not something taught in the is not something, a new subject matter, newly taught for Arjuna in the battlefield of Mahabharatam. Of course, Bhagavad Gita was taught newly in the battlefield, but still the teaching given in the Bhagavad Gita is not something new. Subject matter is the very most ancient subject matter. Most ancient means timeless Shastram. How timeless it is, not only timeless, and it was subject matter of the very Veda itself. Veda is a timeless Shastram, and subject matter of the Veda Shastram is again reproduced here. If it is straight away Veda, it would have been called Shrutihi. But because subject matter of the Veda Shastram, which is timeless scripture, and without distortion, it is reproduced here. Therefore, it is called a Smritihi. That is why we have in the very Dhyana Shlokam itself, there is a beautiful verse. What is that verse? Sarvopanishado gavo dogdha gopalanandana partho vatsa sudhir bhokta dugdham gitamrutam mahat. Which means all the cows are, all the Upanishads are like the cows, and Bhagavad Gita is like the milk extracted from the Upanishad cows. And Krishna says he is only like a milkman. Krishna is only a milkman. He is not the producer of milk, he is only milker, isn't it? But he must have that knack of milking from the cows of Upanishads, isn't it? He must be very intelligent to give you the essence of the teaching. Understanding the teaching itself is difficult, and to assimilate the vision is difficult, and to reproduce, to give you the vision to another person, he gives you the milk means. Now that's the greatness of the teacher, isn't it? That's why Krishna here is, when you study Bhagavad Gita, we do not see anybody else as guru here. Sakshat Bhagavan Krishna is the guru here. Bhagavan is looked upon as a guru. Understand? So which means Krishna is not the producer of the milk. Similarly here, he makes it very clear, this knowledge which is given in Bhagavad Gita, that through the Bhagavad Gita, the knowledge of the subject matter of the Shastram is not something new, very ancient, timeless. To make it, to highlight it, Krishna says, Imam Yogam, this knowledge I had taught before when in the very beginning of creation to Vivaswan. Which means Krishna, the teacher, also is the same. Okay, same teacher taught me. Bhagavan taught then, Bhagavan is the teacher now. Bhagavan, should take the word Bhagavan. Okay, the Lord was the teacher in the beginning. The same Lord who had taught this is the Lord here. But the name is different. Okay, the name form is different, but the Lord alone taught this. The teaching also is the same. That was Veda and this is Gita. Same teaching. Therefore, Imam Yogam Vivasvate Proktavan. And Vivasvate means what? Vivaswan is the name of the sun, and Vivasvat is a Takaranta Pullinga Shabdaha. And Vivasvate is a fourth case, isn't it? Dative. Takarantaha Pullingaha Vivasvat Shabdaha Tasya Chaturthi Vibhakto Eka Vachane Vivasvate Iti Rupam. Doesn't matter. Which means you all are going to study Sanskrit, that's why. So Vivaswan is the name of the sun god, Surya Bhagavan. So I had taught this, was given this knowledge to Vivaswan, and Vivaswan is the foremost of the Surya Vamsha, isn't it? And then Vivaswan gave this to his son, Vaivasvata Manuhu. And then Vivaswan Manave Praha. Then Manu, Vaivaswata Manuhu, son of Vivaswan, gave this wisdom to his son Ikshvakuhu. He mentions only three names. He does not want to give a bigger list of, you know, the teachers in the lineage. He wants to stop here. By mentioning these three names itself, he wants to make it very clear. This teaching is not something new, which I was given in the very beginning and which has been coming downwards through the lineage of teachers. Guru Paramparaya, it has been coming down. So Vivaswan got it from me, and Vivaswan gave it to his son, and his son, Vaivaswatamanu, gave it to his son, Ikshvakuhu. Are we really interested in knowing the list of the names here? No. What is to be understood here? Don't ask. Sometimes the people ask these questions. Okay, well, Manu taught whom? We are not interested in knowing who taught whom. Krishna taught straight directly, you know, Arjuna. And we want to learn what Arjuna learned. So it's only the names are mentioned here just to make us understand. Don't take it for, it's not something new discovery of somebody. Krishna does not say it is something newly I am giving it, okay? Now I am giving it to you. It is my own discovery. No. He just says what? It has been there timelessly. That is the meaning. And little we go little outside of this verse, let us see the meaning of the word Vivaswan, which is again not relevant for us, but still you can know this. Why son is called Vivaswan? I want to tell the meaning of the Vivaswan for, you know, so that we will have reverence for everything in this world. We will not take anything for granted. We will not take sun means a bundle of energy. No. We will look at everything as Devata, manifestation of Ishvara. So we will have reverence for everything. So Vivaswan, son is called Vivaswan because Vivaha, Vivas means Annam. Vivaswan means Annavan. Annavan means what? The one who is endowed with food in its original form of energy. Shakti Rupa Annavan. Isn't it? The energy. Food is in the form of energy where? In sun. So solar energy alone finally gets converted into the food energy which we eat, and all our energy which we are exhausting, we accumulate, then we exhaust. That energy is actually modified form of solar energy. I really don't want to go into how solar energy becomes our energy, explaining photosynthesis, food production, evaporation, condensation, and rains, and then rain falling, and then, you know, crops growing, and then how that energy becomes plant energy becomes food energy becomes our energy, etc. Not even now he has told. Very briefly. Anyway, so basically something, therefore, Vivaswan means what? In fact, This is the same meaning for the word Suryaha also. You know, Sushtu Irayati Iti Suryaha, they say, the one who energizes, enlivens all the beings through nourishment, remaining as the very nutrients, is Surya. Isn't it? What every, the nutrient obtaining in every plant, every vegetable is what? Nothing but the modified energy of the sun. That is why, instead of saying Surya, we have Vivaswan. Understand? Therefore, when you see sun, we really bow to sun. Om Namo Bhagavate Savitre Surya Narayanaya. Early morning, as soon as we get up, even if you don't want to go out and see, sun will come and show his face to you. That is why Pratyaksha Devata. Isn't it? In London, we may have to go out and see, but here, but still, no, because the heat will show in India. Even if you don't want to go out, the heat will wake you up, isn't it? So what I want to say, that is Vivaswan. That is something not connected to the teaching, but still I want to tell you. So this is how this most ancient wisdom has been coming downwards. Now we have to understand one more thing. Here, all these teachers who hail from the Surya Vamsham are all Kshatriyaha, which means this tells us one more thing. Not only there was a Brahmana Guru Parampara, there was also a Kshatriya Guru Parampara. Suppose if you take Dakshina Murtihi and Sanakaha, Sanandanaha, Sanatanaha, Sanat Kumaraha, we had rishis and they're all called what? Brahmana Rishayaha, who came, you know, in the Brahmana Guru Parampara. Now we have Kshatriya Guru Parampara also, like Suryaha, Suryaha, Vivaswan, Vivaswata Manu, Ikshvakuhu, like that we also had, what now, Kshatriya Parampara. Is something important to know. Okay, then, what happened? Such great wisdom, which has been flowing downwards through the lineage, unbroken lineage of teachers, avichinna paramparaya, which has been coming here, such one, in between, somehow has become, you know, lost. Why? Suddenly people lost interest and somehow it became extinct. It was going to become extinct. So he says, Yevam parampara praptam. Imam Rajarshayo Viduhu Sakaleneha Mahata Yogo Nashtav Parantapa Evam Parampara Praptam Imam Rajarshayaha Viduhu. Raja Rishayaha, the kings who were ruling the country, and even they were given this Brahma Vidya. So the wise kings were called Raja Rishayaha. They were not simply administrators. Imagine if an administrator had the wisdom, how excellent, how efficient, how best he would have been, isn't it? Wisdom, administration backed by wisdom. And he would have done the best wonders. He would have done the best he could have done for the society. No? So here, Raja Rishayaha, become what? Rajashayaha. I'll teach you in Sandhi class, okay? Raja Rishayaha, the Kshatriya Rishis, the kings who were wise people, Jnanis, Grihastha Jnanis, householder jnanis, not sannyasi jnanis. Highly responsible kings, they became wise. How? Paramparaya praptam imam yogam. Imam yogam, this wisdom, this knowledge. Which knowledge? The liberating knowledge. The freeing knowledge. The absolute knowledge. Knowledge of the oneness of the individual and the whole, the truth of the individual and the whole, the knowledge of the self, this knowledge, paramparaya praptam, which has been got through the lineage of teachers from time immemorial, no, from timeless time. So he, we say, Rajarshayaha Viduhu, the Rajarshis had this wisdom. But he says, but such knowledge, saha mahata kalena nashtaha. But for a long time, due to the lack of interest on the part of people, somehow this has become extinct. Extinct means what? Completely it's gone away, isn't it? But no, it is was going to disappear. Nashtaha means what? It is lost. That wisdom is lost. Which means if that wisdom should not be lost, what should be done? It has to be revived. Revival is very important here. Therefore, Krishna says, Sayevayam mayatedya. Yogav proktav puratanaha. Bhakto sime sakha cheti. Rahasyam hetaduttamam. Sahayeva ayam yogaha maya adhya proktaha. He Arjuna, the teaching, this knowledge which has been given before, which has been coming down in this Kshatriya parampara and Brahmana parampara, the same wisdom, sahayeva yogaha, the same knowledge, the same teaching, the same wisdom which was given before, which has been coming downwards, no? That knowledge, adhya maya proktaha, puratanaha, the same old ancient wisdom which was given to you by me, Arjuna. Is still being given. What he means is, he has already given in second and third chapters, isn't it? Proktaha. So, puratanaha yogaha maya proktaha. Why did I give this to you? Know that? Me sakacha iti. So, Krishna, again I told you, why did Krishna teach only Arjuna? Why did not he teach anybody else? Because Arjuna chose to ask, Arjuna wanted to know, in fact Arjuna prayed for knowledge. He begged for knowledge. You know, please tell me, aham te sishyaha shadhimam, when you really seek Bhagavan's help, asking for protection, seeking protection, he will not fail, isn't it? So here she says, bhaktaha asi me sakha cha iti. Me sakha, me bhaktaha. Two things. Arjuna had two qualifications. One is what? He was friend of Arjuna. You know, sakha means friend. Literally it means friend. Friend means not any friend. Nowadays, no, whoever we call somebody friend today, and after 1 week we'll say they're enemy. This is not friendship. Sakha means samana khyanau. Samana khyanaha sakha. The one who is of same inclinations, same interests, is called samana khyanaha. My inclination and other person's inclination is the same, then samana khyana. Understand? So the one for whom dharma is the paramaha, no, ahimsa is the paramaha dharmaha. One for whom the ahimsa, the non-violence, non-injury, non-hurting is the exalted of the values. And for other person, if the same value is the exalted of the values, they both are committed to the same value, same dharma, then they are samana khyana. Sakha. Understand now? That's what sakha. And I am committed to values. I know the value of values. Other person is also equally, you know, committed to the values. Knowing the value of values means our friendship is based on, our intimacy is based on our commitment to dharma. That is where my trust in my friend is total. Other person's trust in me also can be total. It's a total trust. There's no distrust at all. Between friends, the trust should be there. Is it the trust is possible? Trusting it is possible only if our intimacy is based on our commitment to dharma. Then no, nothing can come and break that intimacy and closeness also. So sakha means what? Sakha is here is, hey Arjuna, you are my sakha. That word implies so much. What I value, you also value. That is why you are sakha. To be a friend of Bhagavan, what do we need to do? If we live our lives in conformity with dharma, if we live our lives in harmony with the universal law and order, Now, if our lifestyle, if the way of life we live does not disturb the universal harmony, then naturally we are all Bhagavan. We have Bhagavan as a Sakha. So Arjuna, Krishna says, you are my Sakha. Me Sakha Chaiti, and also what? Me Bhaktaha Asicha. You're also my devotee. Next, Bhaktaha means, I told you Bhaktaha again, which devotee? You are not an ordinary devotee. Krishna and Arjuna, they're contemporaries. They're playmates like. Krishna goes as a servant, goes as a charioteer for him, as a driver. Does not mean that, you know, Krishna is, you know, Arjuna is, how much Krishna sees Arjuna? How does he see Arjuna? To understand, because Bhaktaha means, he is not the one who prays to, seeks Bhagavan's Krishna's help only when he is in trouble. Not such a devotee. And he is not an ordinary devotee who seeks Bhagavan's help for, you know, artha pursuit, for some security or some pleasures. In fact, he really, in this the present context, he bows to Krishna. He bowed to Krishna, praying for knowledge. This is, he is a real devotee. When Arjuna bowed to Krishna, asking for jnanam, Sadhimam Twam Prapannam Unnai Sharandanda Ennai Kapatruvayaha. You know, please protect me, the one who has surrendered to you. And then please Bruhi Tadyekam Nischitya Bruhi. Please tell me that one thing which will free me from sorrow. When he sought Jnanam, he sought Krishna's help. We don't go to Bhagavan for help. We are not intelligent enough to seek help. An intelligent person should seek help. And when he sought help, you know, and when he sought help in terms of protection, he sought in terms of protection, and in terms of, he asked for jnanam. Asking for jnanam made Arjuna the real devotee. Not an artha bhaktaha, not an arthi bhaktaha, but a jignasu bhaktaha, a real devotee. Which means he is all eligible to become the jnani bhaktaha, the sreshta bhaktaha, the best of the devotees. So here, therefore, bhaktaha asi and sakha asi. That is the reason you deserve my teaching. I teach you. Iti yetad uttamam. This is the uttamam. There is no greater knowledge than knowledge of the self. This is the absolute knowledge, paravidya. It is this knowledge which alone will liberate a person from bondage. It will help a person take ownership of the fullness, the happiness which is already there. Therefore, uttamam jnanam. And rahasyam. It's also like it's a secret. Why it's a secret? Because what is sought by you happens to be the very seeker's swarupam. It is a secret. As long as you search for what you are searching for externally other than yourself, this, no, what you seek will be playing a hide and seek game. If you go there, it is behind you. Wherever you go, it is behind you, not in front of you. Behind means what? Not behind. Isn't it? Therefore, it is a secret. It is called a secret. This knowledge is called a secret because what is to be known, what is to be accomplished, what is sought is not an object at all. It is the very swarupam of the seeker. Therefore, it is said to be what? Rahasyam. Yetad rahasyam uttamam. Isn't it? Jnanam. Atat te aham pravakshyami. I am going to give you that wisdom again. I am going to teach you. I am going to give you the same teaching, same wisdom I am going to give you, which is rahasyam and uttamam. Why do I give it? You are my sakha. And you are my bhaktaha. You are my devotee and you are my friend. Okay? This is. Now, when we heard all these three verses, all of us must have had many doubts now. If we do not have doubts, we'll know the doubt from Arjuna's question, following question. Or we all must have had the doubts. How is it possible for Krishna to teach sun? S-U-N, sun. And Krishna's birthday we all know very well. Is it? Shravana Mase, Gokula Ashtamyam Tithau, Rohini Nakshatre. Is it? On such and such a date of birth is there, and every year we all celebrate his date of birth with Sidai, Murukku, Ellurundai, and what all sweets, what all we like. Don't plan now for cooking next day, okay? So, okay, we want break? Radhaji will give me signal, huh? Apidaji will tell me signal, so then I know. So here, celebrated, which means Krishna and Arjuna were contemporaries. Krishna lived when Arjuna lived. And that's why Krishna could teach Arjuna. And how come Krishna had taught Vivaswan? If I tell you now, you know, you're all sitting in front of me. I had taught this Bhagavad Gita to your great-great-grandfather in Sri Lanka. You all were not there that time. If I tell you, will you believe? Because you know my age. And you, I'm sitting in, you can, maybe more or less you can make out. Definitely, I must be of certain age. And your great-great-grandfather, you yourself do not know. Which, how many, you know, years back, Swamini would not even have born that time. Now she is telling us she had taught my great-great-grandfather in Sri Lanka. You will think it's a bluff, isn't it? But Arjuna did not think it was a bluff, because the speaker was not me or anybody else. It was Krishna himself. Because Arjuna revered Krishna as a teacher and had trust in Krishna's words as a teacher, had faith in Krishna as a teacher. Faith was there in the teaching and the teacher, Shastram and the teacher. Now Guru Shraddha is there, Shraddha he had. So he did not doubt, he did not think it was a bluff, but still he was not sharp enough to appreciate it. He wanted clarification. He did not ask, not for any doubting or testing or challenging Krishna, but for his own clarification. With politeness, he expressed. He asked. What did Arjuna ask? That's going to come in the next verse. Arjuna uvacha, aparam bhavato janma,
param janma vivasvatah,
kathametadvijaniyam,
Tvamadau proktavaniti.
Now Arjuna is asking, Bhavataha Janma Aparam. Vivaswataha Janma Param. Is it? Vivaswan's birth was much, 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 much ahead of yours. Not even few hundreds of years. know, the difference between your birth and Vivaswan's birth, you know, many millennia, not just a few hundreds of years, not in 1 millennium, okay, many millennia is the in-between. Because the very beginning of the Srishti, Vivaswan was there. Vivaswan was born. And I know your birthday recently. I mean, you are my contemporary. So Bhavataha Janma, he talks about Krishna's birth. Bhavataha Janma, you know, Bhavataha, you all remember? Very good. Bhavataha Janma Aparam. Your birth was much later now, recently, during my times. Whereas Vivaswataha Janma Param, much before was Vivaswan's birth. Now, why Bhavataha, Vivaswataha? Both words are Takaranta Shabdas. Okay? Bhavat Shabdaha, Vivaswat Shabdaha. Therefore, what is possessive form of Vivaswan and Bhavan? Vivaswataha, Bhavataha. Understand? Bhavataha Janma, Vivaswataha Janma. Your birth and Vivaswan's birth. Both are Takaranta Pullinga Shabdas. Therefore, possessive is the same. Your birth was much later. Vivaswan's birth was much before yours. Katham Yetad Vijaniyam Tvam Ado Proktavaniti. How can I understand this? I can't understand this, that you had taught, you know, I understand, I believe what you say, but I can't understand this fact that you had taught Vivaswan. Tvam Ado, in the very beginning of creation, you had taught son, Tvam Proktavan Ado Iti Katham Aham Vijaniyam. How can I understand? This is something for me not at all understandable. It is true for all of us, isn't it? Which means, now Krishna is not like any other ordinary human beings. Isn't it? So we have to say, if we can. So he says, now to make him understand, Krishna is the incarnation, avataraha, of Bhagavan. So from this verse onwards, by way of answering Arjuna's question, by way of clarifying Arjuna's doubt, Krishna also brings to light the avataraha, subject matter of avatara. Look at this.
Shri Bhagavan Uvacha. Bahuni me vyatitani. Janmani tava charjuna. Tanyaham veda sarvani. Natvam vetha parantapa.
Krishna says, me janmani bahuni vyatitani, many of my births have gone. Tavacha, not only mine, you also had many births before. I also had many births before. Both of us had many births before. Tavacha mamacha bahuni janmani vyatitani kadandana palapirappugal kadandana. Now many lives have gone before this life. This present birth and the present life is one of the births, isn't it? Life led in one of the births. So many births before have gone, of mine, also of yours. Which means we are all not suddenly born in this life. We also have been there, what? Timelessly. Bhagavan also has been there timelessly. Bhagavan also must have had many avatars before. And we also had many births before. What is the difference? The avatar Purusha knows the many births of a jiva. And avatar Purusha knows many of his previous avatarams. But a jiva will not know his own previous births. Therefore, there's no way of knowing anybody else's births also. That is the only difference. Understand? It won't be clear now. Don't worry. We'll wait. Tani aham sarvani, tani sarvani aham veda. I know all of them. I know all my previous avataras. I also know all your previous births. Understand? Avatara Purusha knows. But he says, natvam vetha parantapa. But you do not know them. You as an individual jiva, you do not know them. Whereas I know all of them. Is it clear? He says, how is it possible for Krishna to know this? Because Krishna is an avataraha. And before we enter into the topic of avatara, I want to tell you few important things here. Whenever this avatara topic comes, immediately we get little confused or doubtful or somehow. We have to know one thing, important thing. See, avataraha means descending, isn't it? Irangi varudal, avataranam. Taranam means crossing. Avataranam means coming down. Coming down, not simply falling, but descending. Avataraha or avataranam. In Sangeetam, we have avarohanam. Isn't it? But what about the janma, birth? Avataraha, incarnation or descending. But ours is a janma. Ajnani jivasya janma, bhagavataha avataraha. Bhagavan's avatara and an individual person's jivas, birth. What is the difference between birth and an avatara? Some difference must be there. We have to understand the difference. There's a difference in cause. There's a difference in nature. There's a difference in purpose. There is karane janma na for avatarasya karanam. Janmanaha karanam. There's a difference in the cause also. Why the birth, cause of the jiva's birth is ajnanam. Isn't it? Why are you born here? Ignorance is the cause. Ignorance is the cause of everyone's birth. If you ask me the question, why am I born here? Why are we all born here? We are all born. The cause is ignorance. If there's no ignorance, then you wouldn't have been born. Ajnanam is the janmanaha karanam. Understand? Whereas avataraha is not born of ignorance. That's why, and when we are born, in fact, no choice. Because of ignorance, what do we have? Because ignorance is natural, uncreated ignorance. And because of ignorance, there is erroneous self-perception. Because of erroneous self-perception, there is superimposition of limitations of non-self upon the self. Thereby, we all have wrong self-image. And because of wrong self-image, wrong notions about the self, we have that what is the small sense of smallness, sense of inadequacy centered on I. Therefore, I am small, that notion is very strong. Therefore, we have need, there's a need for us to become bigger than what we are, okay, to become full. And because of this need, there comes desires. And the desires result in actions. Actions produce phalam, fruits, and the fruits have to be exhausted. For exhausting the fruits, we are born. Understand? Why are we born? Because for exhausting punya papas. Why do we have punya papas? Because we accumulated. How do we accumulate? By performing karma. Why do we perform why did we perform karma? Because we had desires to fulfill. Why did we have desires? Because we had needs. Why did we have needs? Because we were small and inadequate. We had the notion that we were small and inadequate. Why did we have that notion? Because we can't help. We think, we see ourselves as small and inadequate. Because we see ourselves wrongly. We see ourselves through what we have, what we own, etc. Because we do not know what we are. And not only that, we do not know that we do not know what you are. So, moola karanam, even though, understand, the moola karanam for the birth is ajnanam. Is it clear? Therefore, we have no choice. Did we have any choice? No. It is not our choice. We were pushed. Whether we like it or not, I don't want to go. No, you have to be born. We had no choice of being born here. Choicelessly, we were pushed down. In a sense, understand? That is why it's called fall. It is not taranam. It is not our taranam. Not slowly, carefully getting down. It is fall. Choiceless fall is janma. But avataranam means avatarasya karanam jnanam, not ajnanam. Jnanam. There is knowledge. There is no ajnanam. Therefore, this birth also is what now? Choice. The avatar also is choice. It's a choice. Is there. It is not the fall. The person who knows how to swim very well, the one who is used to get into the well and search for things and take it out, suppose in villages and all, even you in Sri Lanka would have noticed. Those days, no, we never had these bore well pumps, no? We had only proper wells. I'm talking about when it was in villages, even now we had villages, we also have borders, but we've had the proper wells. And we had something happens means the person has to, there'll be some steps and had to go carefully and walk down and then see. And have something falls into the well also, they get into the well, jump into the well, and they swim and then they take water they need to take. Sometimes our children, we put something. And they can go and take it out and come back. That is avatara. Understand? Getting down. Comfortably, person knows how to get in, how to get out. There is no why I am getting in also, he knows. To the well. The purpose, he knows why I am going, very clear. And once he comes out again, he doesn't need to go in again. Isn't it? He comes for a given purpose. He gets into the well for taking something lost, put into the well. He takes it out, picks it up, comes out carefully, without any strain, any pain, any struggle. again forgets about. Again and again he doesn't want to go. Doesn't need to go, isn't it? Again something falls. Again something gets stuck in the well. He has to go and correct it. Again if the necessity is there, he can go. He has choice. He can get into the well if there's necessity. Or he does not need to go. And there's no fear of getting drowned in that water also, because he knows how to swim, how to get into the well, how to be in the water, how to hold the breath, how to swim, how to take things, and then how to come back comfortably. In fact, it's fun for him, isn't it? Leela. He comes out. He knows. Isn't it? It's choice. It is avatara. But suppose you go and see what is there in the well. You're pushed into the well. That is called what? That is like, oh my God, I'm fall. I don't know how to get out of it. I don't know how to get out of this water. You know, I'm struggling for my life. I don't know how to swim also. Even if I know swimming in this well water, I don't know how to swim because it's too much of water. Isn't it? And you can't even see. You see for somewhere up. You can't even see because so dark, too deep well, isn't it? Which is not a avatara. It is patanam. Patana karanam. Not avataranam. It's a big difference, isn't it? Got difference now? What is avataraha? What is patanam? Fall. So janma is a fall of a jiva. Helpless, choiceless fall of a jiva. Whereas avatara is a choiceful, purposeful, isn't it? Descending of the Lord. So jnana karanam, the knowledge is the karanam for avataram, but ajnanam is the karanam for jiva janma. Understand? Birth of a jiva. Then, the nature of the jivaha, nature of the avataraha. You see the nature, the jiva's body is a bhautika deha. It's a combination of elements, isn't it? It's a product of elements. Elemental product is the jiva's deha, which means the original matter in the form of maya again evolves into elements. Then from the elements again what? There's a grossification. Again from the grossified elements alone the plants come into existence, and then from there we get the food, and from that only this physical body, human, the physical body, jiva shariram, not only ours, any body of any living being is what? Product of elements. Bhautika shariram. Bhautika dehaha. It is not directly from the original matter, but it is from the modified matter. Converted matter. Okay, whereas Ishvara Shariram is directly from the original matter. Directly it becomes the Shariram. Mayikam Shariram. So Bhautika Dehaha is the Jiva's body, whereas Maya product, the original cause, without undergoing changes, the Maya itself becomes the body for an avatara. Mayika Shariram, Bhautika Shariram. This is the difference. The nature of the avatara, the body, the difference in the nature is, avatara's body is elemental, sorry, Maya product, and then Jiva's body is elemental product. Bhautika Shariram, Mayika Shariram. Bhautika Dehaha, Mayika Dehaha. That is why if you analyze the birth of any avatara, there will be something will be there. In Puranas, you can understand. Take for example, Rama. Not something like not, Kaushala did not conceive like how others conceived. There's some yajna was performed, payasam was given to her, and some special thing is there in birth. Also Krishna. Are lots of confusions. Now, parents were put in jail. He was born elsewhere, asked to be brought here. You know, Krishna was always said to be Maya, isn't it? Suddenly, appeared as a child, he was in the form of a Rohini, Maya. All stories we have. The stories all try to present something very abstract. See, modified matter, body is a product of modified matter. Modified, then Jiva Shariram. Whereas Avatara Shariram is not the modified matter, the original matter. If you take Narasimha Avataram, you know, again, suddenly appeared. We heard about, only Puranas try to depict that story. You know, what you want to understand is, it is originally Mayika Shariram. But anyway, it's also matter. Okay, don't touch, okay? Any matter only. So, Jeeva Shariram also is matter. Avatara Shariram is also matter. Material in nature, therefore inert. Any body is inert. Then Uddesha. Uddesha is the purpose. Purpose of the avatara, purpose of janma. When jiva is born, what is the purpose? Purpose of the jiva, even though the ultimate purpose is to discover moksha, to know the truth, ultimate is different. But mainly jiva's birth is for exhaustion of punya papas, in the form of prarabdha, a part of sanchitam accumulated from timeless time, isn't it? Time immemorial. Is it clear now? So jiva's birth is for punya papa kshayartam. Punya papa, not kshayartam, punya papa anubhavartam, isn't it? For exhaustion, for exhausting the punya papas in terms of prarabdha, you have to pay, isn't it? Where we have taken loans before, we have to repay our debts. And where we, what all we caused pain to, we have to go through that pain. The pain, pleasure, sukham, dukkham, we have to experience. Purely for experiencing, going through the pairs of opposites in terms of pains and pleasures, in keeping their punya papas, the birth is ordained. Understand? So, prarabdha, for exhausting prarabdha karma phalam alone, the jiva's birth is ordained. Well, if intelligent jiva can exhaust the prarabdha and escape from this, otherwise, you again continue. Whereas, Avatara Purusha's birth is not for exhausting karma. It's not born of karma, isn't it? Not born of Ajnanam also. It is for Loka Sangrahartham. Or you can say Dharma Rakshanartham. For whenever we are going to see that, for only protecting Dharma, to bring the disorder back to, whenever there is disorder, the social, whenever there's a universal harmony is disturbed, there's disorder in, and to remove that, to correct the disorder, to bring the disorder back to order, to maintain the balance, isn't it? Everything, to keep everything balanced, there is avatara. So, for protecting dharma, avataraha, there is descending. Is it clear? This is the purpose. Now, we'll come back and see the rest of the things. Okay? Don't take seriously now. Come back. I'll tell you important things. Don't come.